thanks for having me. I do hail from Jasper, Indiana. It's Dubois County, kind of a neat place to grow up. My wife, 41 years, we were high school sweethearts, and managed to make it into college. We got married the year when we graduated, and Jim's point about, you know, your hometown roots. So we lived out east for 2 years while I was getting a master's in business administration. At that time, I was naive in the sense that I wanted to get away and live somewhere else for a little while, just to kind of see what the difference would be. And when we sized up what we were going to do with the rest of our life in the beginning, we were different. We were unusual. We both wanted to end up moving back to our hometown. And the opportunities that were out there were amazing. After you do go through that, but there's something about it. We chose where we wanted to live over what we wanted to do. And that was probably the most important decision we made. Started our family, got four kids. Three of the four work in the business with me. If there's anything more gratifying than that, I don't know what it would be. Our first three grandkids, they happen to live in Jasper too, so my business, my in-laws, my son and daughter-in-law, the three grandkids are all within about 10 minutes of one another. I wouldn't give that up for anything. Begs the question, why do you want to run for U.S. Senate? Man who take you away from that. And the other question I get is, do you need to have your head examined to do something like that? When you've got it so good and you've been part of the state legislature that you can really feel things that they get done. You know, when we passed the road funding bill, being in the logistics business, and a guy that could never vote for a tax increase for something for consumption, had to really search in my own mind, does that make sense? Most of us were convinced that in a state like this, where you balance your budget, you don't live beyond your means, that maybe this would make sense in the long run. I always like to take a shortcut when I come to someplace, so I got to Bloomfield, looked at the map, could have headed up 231. I took State Road 157. So, I've been on some of those adventures before, so I get a mile down the road and it says local traffic only, loose gravel. I thought, no, I'm not gonna turn around. It looked like I was gonna have to go 15 minutes out of the way. So I took the gamble, and that road's paved all the way from north of Bloomfield into Clay City. So it was a smart move, and I made it up here in a little over an hour and a half. When I become your next U.S. Senator, I've got a big deal in mind. There are six of us running. Four of us come from basically outside of politics. I've been a legislator for 3 years, was on our school board for 10 years prior to that. So I'm hoping I got just enough experience to where I'm not tainted by the system. When you're a legislator, we're actually doing things, I think, that count. 52% of our budget is education. Roads come into play. Medicaid is part of what we spend money on, but I view it more like how a city runs. You do things that make a difference. One thing that's disappointing me, and made me stick my neck out to do this, is I see so many people that we send to D.C. talking to the game. They are conservatives on paper. They've got all the platitudes, they go out there, and then in one case, I've got an opponent who does not live in the state of Indiana anymore and wants to represent us. You know, that's a decision you make. And when you decide to live somewhere else other than the state you're representing, I think that's something you need to, you know, consider. My opponents that are leading the pack currently, and I'm catching up every day, have both been in politics their entire careers. I've been a conservative that's had to live it in the trenches. When you build a business from 17 years where you're still that size, you can put up with every roadblock, every impediment that can be thrown in front of you. I've been doing it 36 years. We've had the benefit of a lot of hard work of growing into a small, medium, and now a business that we're in all lower 48 cities. And three to four kids work in the business, and believe me, when you're tackling something like that, sometimes you just throw your hands up in the air and say, is it worth it to do it? Never forget when we moved into California. I didn't think there'd be a place harder to do business with than the federal government. There is a place, California. So we're happy that we finally made it into the big leagues of being a national distributor. And we get our first warehouse out there. All kinds of vacancy. Nobody wanted a warehouse in California, and I was kind of suspicious for that reason. Well, the rules and regulations of doing business in a place like that, people are moving out of that state. They're moving into states like a state like Indiana that at least makes you feel welcome. Some called and said, Dad, it's a great place. The rates are even low. And I said, well, that's surprising. They said, well, nobody wants to have a business in California. We had to have one. We normally send our own crew to set up the route. I said, you know, I want to get some people to do it there just in case it gets to be a lot of red tape. We hired a company to do it. It normally takes us a month and a half. It took them 3 months. They had the racking off 1 inch on a 60,000 square foot warehouse. The inspector comes through, makes them tear it all down. So they lost, I don't know how much money. We normally get in business in a month or two, 1 year, until we can open up and do what you can do in any other state in a month or two. If I become your senator, I'm not doing it for the money. Many of the people who go to D.C. do it because they make maybe more money being a federal legislator than they knew of what they were doing before. If they're making a living at it, they're also going to calculate a little different on how they might vote. I can guarantee if you elect me, I'll be doing it from conservatism based on the Constitution and based upon living it in the trenches of being a small business person, somebody who believes in liberty, and will vote that way when I get out there. I'm not doing it to get reelected. The most, if I get elected, would be a run for one more term. I believe in term limits at the federal level. If we had it, occasionally you get a good guy out of there, but mostly you get a bunch of good people that would stick their neck out to serve at the federal level if they didn't have to build a life and a career around it. And you certainly wouldn't get people calculating how they're going to vote. And they talk a good game of conservatism, get up there and change it because they got to fall in line with leadership. Or they don't want to make the wrong vote because it may be tough on their re-election day. You won't have that out of me. The big deal you find when you do something like this is when you're in the position of being a federal legislator, you've got the ability to fundraise into your congressional campaign account. You can save yourself with desired promotion for a long time, and you can shovel all that money into your next elected job that you would desire. So the main reason most people don't get involved with it, when we got into the fine print of what it's going to take to really put a credible campaign together, it's made for the insiders. It's made for the incumbents. If we don't do something I'd work on if I get there, is I'd try to get a law number one when you decide to get out of Congress or the Senate. Most don't, but when they do, a lot of times they jump in and become a lobbyist. That's the worst of both worlds. You've just been representing people, and then you're jumping into the people that shovel all the money at you to help you get reelected. There ought to be a law. It's only now 1 year to where when you get out of office, you only have to wait a year to become a lobbyist. That ought to be fine. You shouldn't be able to jump from an elected office to become a lobbyist when there's that kind of conflict of interest. Term limits, never going to be brought up by the powers that be. I'll still talk about it. And one thing to get out of me is anything that's important to Hoosiers, I'm not going to be beholden to anyone. I'm raising my funds with my own skin and name. It's hard when you're conservative and you work as hard as I have to build a business and have to use the kind of resources you'll need to be competitive here. I will. And I'm going to fundraise through individuals. There'll be very few packs for people that normally shovel money into the troughs of people that have been there. So I hope that gives you a good picture that you'll have a conservative that's lived it. And when I get there, I won't change colors. I'll be your true representative for the state of Indiana. Please keep me in mind and would love your support as we go on and I'll answer any questions you have. Yes, sir.
Do you believe in repealing Obamacare and putting in another government program, or just repealing Obamacare?
Good question. Health care is a mess. It's the biggest thing we've spent money on in my own business. We've actually found ways through the free market system to lower costs. We did it 8 years ago. We reduced costs by 50% in a company there in 8 years. My employees have not had to pay a penny more for their health insurance today than they did 8 years ago. That's the free market. That's the business world. I want a clean repeal of Obamacare. I do want conservatives, though, to start speaking up and not fall in line with big health care, the big business of health care. That's insurance companies, hospitals, and others. We need to be able to buy and sell insurance across state lines. That's a protection for insurance companies. No other industries have that luxury where you don't have competition from out of state. Individuals need to be able to pool and be part of associations so you're not out there in the single policy market. And we do not want some type of version of Obamacare that's just Obamacare light. So we need something that's going to have true free market principles similar to what we did in our own business. I didn't get any help from the insurance companies. We brought it out of them and found a way to make it work. So you need to throw all that at it. If you don't, this thing's going to march to a one-payer system. It'll be a shame because there are ways to avoid it. Good question. Yes, sir. We need to have a border that is impenetrable. That idea of where our legal border had was forced to where we could come and go doesn't make sense. You don't have a country if you can't control who comes in. I welcome any immigrants. We're a country of immigrants. You've got to come through legally. Any negotiations on any part of the immigration problem, to me, is a non-starter until you can say with certainty that you have nobody coming into your country illegally. If that means you have to build a wall, the entirety of it, which you probably don't, but you need that in places where you can now see on TV where you pick the fence up and you go underneath. And until we stop that, whatever we do to resolve the issues that still remain, it's wasting time and effort. And I hope that that happens. If the Republicans roll over on that, Obamacare, I don't think they're Republicans.
Who's your opponent that lives out of state?
What's that?
Who's your opponent that lives out of state?
Luke Messner. He does not have a residence in the state of Indiana. I'm not. Everybody in this race is probably a decent conservative, other than if you've been in politics, especially at the federal level for a long time, you change your way of looking at things. And I'd say for all of you, you got a decent conservative voting record. Messer, not quite as much. I look more at the dynamic of what they've done with their careers. If you think they can be objective and not be positioning for the next thing they want to do in politics, choose one because they've got experience. If you want somebody who's going to be just as smart knows how government works, but doesn't have any of those excuses, I think you ought to look at me. But yes, I think you ought to be living in Indiana, even if it's inconvenient. You should still have a home in our state that you're going to represent us. And I don't know how that could be legally to do it, but it can get by. Yes, sir. Question, what is the role of federal government in education? To me, it should be zero. That was one of the things left to the states. We know with Common Core and with other things, it assumes that there's only one way to educate kids. And a lot of times we end up doing some of the same things, but the flexibility ought to be for the states to do it. They pay for it. The way they want to educate their kids in their state. I think the federal government's got its hands full and it doesn't pay for what it does already. Running $500 billion deficits and bragging about it because it's down from the trillion. I think there are several reasons why that ought to be left to the states and feds ought to stay out. Get another question that's asked often. What would you do with North Korea? So, first of all, it has not snuck up on us. It's been 20 to 25 years. And that kind of foreign policy that gives everybody a second chance, especially when you've got to be the baddest actor and player that we've ever seen on the national scene. Three or four things that you don't hear much about that would be before you'd have to make a preemptive strike. If they keep a lot of missiles, sooner or later there'd be one that's armed. You've got naval blockades. Haven't heard much about it, but we've got the biggest fleet in the world, and that's one thing you can do. Your defensive missile system. To me, there's not a better time and place if they keep launching missiles and doing it right over an ally. It's a place to see if your defense system is working. And the other thing is, China is now dependent on our economy. They weren't 10 years ago. And they've got more to lose than anybody. Something has to be done to get them in where they put more pressure on North Korea. Otherwise, it'll end up in a calamity. And it's a shame. That's a result of a weak foreign policy over many years. And now we're at the point of where you could have some type of destruction.
Ironic, because colleges used to be the bastion of free speech.
that was back in the 60s and 70s. And now it's reversed the other way to where you've got a conservative point of view. You may not even get a venue to speak. I think that that can probably be solved. Rather than passing laws, you just need to enforce what's already on the books as a constitutional right and ought to be enforced from that direction. Because you should not muffle a voice just because you disagree with it. Colleges now are doing that across the board for ever anyone who speaks a conservative point of view.
Now, a federal judge will support the colleges, most likely, if we get a change.
Then we'll need to see if the ACLU are hypocrites, because they ought to be enforcing it just like they do the other one. And there are places out there that, yes, they probably won't. They probably won't. It's sad, but that's, you know, just getting. The other thing is sad is as costly as it is to send your kids to school, and you send them there, and you're paying all that money, and they're getting indoctrinated. The one statistic from this last election that floored me, look at the millennials. Were the only ones voting, there would have been only two states that would have gone for Trump. Only two states, if it were the millennials voting only, West Virginia and Kentucky. That made me sick, because they're going to be the people that the reins are going to be handed to in a generation. And what happens? Not all millennials are like that, but that was to be a sad statistic.
I would like to make a statement and ask you a question.
Sure.
Okay. I had the feeling that when the Congress was addressing Obamacare, I had the feeling that there was no one there who knew how to do it. And so your statement of saying that you had run a business and you knew how to run a business and to do things like that, that was impressive to me. So how do you feel about that? Does the rest of you feel like they didn't know what to do? They didn't know how to address it? They didn't know how to begin to address it? And I would like to go in there and show them.
I would like to choke
them.
When you have so much money coming in, you've got to pay. First you do your tithe. You give your 10% to the Lord. And then you pay your bills. If there's anything left over, you can go have an ice cream. Or you can go out for dinner. So I would have loved to go in there and show them how to do it.
Oh, John McCain.
Well, good point. I'll tell you one. So, first year I got to the state house, I was all full of energy and to do some things that were important to me. So I tried to do two simple bills, and it was about healthcare transparency. This is starting in our own state. I had a simple request. Anybody that's in the healthcare business, publish your price in print or online. All the money we spend, especially with higher deductibles, I'd like to know that. And then I also wanted a bill that said the Medicare price, which is less, because big government bargains with big business to knock it down, and it's less money than what we all pay through insurance. Well, it was the next day, I went to talk to the committee chair and said, are you going to give me a hearing? That phone rang off the hook. From the lobby in our own state that got the chairman of the two committees that have to go through, I couldn't even get to first base on something that simple. But I learned a lesson from it. So instead of just forgetting about it, last year I said, well, I'm going to maybe call a press conference about healthcare issues. Would you want to discuss it? Jim, I got a hearing. Informally, but not going a formal hearing, but it was a step in the right way. You got to be willing to keep plugging, you got to know what to do, and you can't be afraid to ruffle some feathers. Again, I could have, if you do some things that the committee chairs don't like, you know, they'll put you over in the corner with a dunce hat on, and you don't get to do anything. So, you got to be careful. You got to know how to play the game, but you can't be overtaken by the game. Hope that makes sense. Thanks for having me. Enjoyed it. This is a good sized group. A looks like you were energized with your politics, so I can appreciate your support, and hopefully I can earn your vote along the way. Thank you.